next stage of the charger. Got it sitting up on stands, got the spirit level out, got it all sitting square and level, ready to start working on the back floor and rear tail panel. So if you've seen, the wheelhouse is finished, and I've just knocked up a little frame at the back here. Had my original frame, which I used on the 70 charger, the last one I did, which is welded up to the chassis rail up front and bolts to the factory four bolts that they use on the rear of the chassis rails. So it keeps that all square and solid. And then I've just knocked up a quick little frame just to support the quarter panels, just in case it wants to move. It shouldn't really, but I am taking out the middle so that I'm going to save the tail light panel, but I'm removing the rear valance and the rear cross member. So effectively the middle there is going to be disconnected from the rail and the tail light panel. So this is just a little bit of extra security just to make sure it doesn't pull down or move, which I don't think it will, but just to be sure. So once that's all, I've just started all drilling out the little spot welds. Once that's done and I take that tail panel off, then I've got to do a little bit of work on the back edge where the rail connects to the cross member. Once that's fitted, then I can start putting the floor in, and then I can put the rear valance back on. So got to do one thing at a time, and because in this car I'm not doing the tops of the quarters, there's much less work around the frame of the boot jam, which is good on this car. Obviously the boot lid is got to go. I've got a new boot lid for it. Yeah, so just one section at a time, and looking forward to getting all that structure back in. Then I can start thinking about putting quarter panels on and the more fun stuff. So moving along, now I've got the rear cross member in. There was a couple of very small repairs right on the back edge of the chassis rail where the it actually half mounts to that rear cross member. So I reworked that slightly. And now I've got the floor in position. I've got this just loose. I've only unpicked that in the bottom, so that'll bend back down again into position without taking that off. And I've had all the holes drilled, plugged for the plug weld. And then there's screws, various screws in all sorts of different places, and clamps to get the boot floor tight down to the rails. You must have it nice and tight. You can't have it hanging up in the air and knock it down. You've got to get it nice and flat. So it's sitting really well. I'm really happy with how it's sitting. I think it helps having factory original chassis rails. It just fits beautiful. So I can now go ahead and plug weld that in, and then I'll be able to plug weld in the wheelhouses. The bottom of this wheelhouse needs to be made, but it's going to be easier to do it with the floor in there. Same with this side, there's a little patch there. But other than that, it's just about there. So once the boot floor's all welded in, then I can put the rear valance on. And also to note, you can't get the boot floor in these cars in one piece unless you've got the tail light panel out or the rear valance out. Otherwise you just can't get it. It's physically too big. So we're able to slide the boot floor in from behind and then clamp it all into position. So it's looking really good, nice and square. Weld it in now. A few more hours of welding, clamping, tapping, welding. It's a fiddly job, but it's looking good. Look at that. Beautiful, nice and tight to the floor. All the plug welds in, like factory. Still leaving this up yet, because I'm going to do the tail panel next. I've connected the wheelhouses as far as I can. I've got to make a little bottom section there, and a little corner section there. I'll see if we can have a quick look underneath. Bit hard to tell probably, but nice and tight. Beautiful. So one more step towards a rust-free car. Still got a bit to go yet. So coming to the final days, my shiny paint side of work is finished, and just setting up a few things for my buddy Mark. Hello, Mark.
Hello, Brian. Back again.
Mark's from Northern EFI. He helps me out with any of my modern car stuff.
and he does a lot of hot rodding and modifying with modern engines in old cars, as well as modern engines in modern cars. In this case, it's a Hellcat. Now look at that. 707 factory, is it?
707, yeah. Factory crane engine, yeah.
But of course, Mark's probably not going to be satisfied with that. No. So what's the plan you're going to do with the motor?
Not too much, because just judging it and the weight and everything on the car, we might kill ourselves. On the
yeah, good point.
There's no IRS and ABS and traction and all that sort of stuff. So,
yeah.
Look, we're just going to put probably just the cam springs and a couple of pulley upgrades on it, which still will push it up
to another 100 horsepower.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Look, the cam's more just because of the car and the quality of it. It's more for the sound.
Yeah, you want to have that old school sound to it. Yeah.
Yeah, just for something. So, look, we don't really want to push any more.
No, there's still more power than you could ever use in a car like this.
Well, that's it. Look, the idea is that we do have pulleys and upgrades for it, so we can bring it up, but we can easily just bring it back
that's
down.
That's true, yeah. You could always adjust it back down again.
Not as easy as a turbo car. You can just wind the boost up, but we can
And so what, it's got to look like a modern-day front suspension. This is totally different to what Brian does, but that's good. Everyone's got their own ideas. Well, so this is, what suspension is it?
This is, the beauty of this car is that everything's on the shelf. So there's a company in America, Modern Muscle Extreme.
Right.
And they basically had the independent front end for it.
Yep.
Which bolt the engine to it, the pipes fit. It runs, still going to run a 727.
Yep.
Ideally, we'd like to put a 6-speed or whatever, 8-speed, whatever they are.
Yeah.
Just for the time being, we'll just run with the 3-speed.
A lot of modifying to make those fit, though. You got to cut the floor and transmission crossmember and everything to make those fit.
And sensors and
all the
stuff that you've done previous, but we sort of cheated this time.
Yeah.
But it comes with, disc brake front end and the fuel tank. They make a fuel tank for it, which basically is the EFI sender in the factory tank, bolt straight in,
pipes bolt straight up. And the pump as well,
Even the radiator with the thermostat, everything's sort of like a bolt in. You can just click, choose, and take the easy way out. So that's what we did with this one.
Yeah. So relatively straightforward in the respect of everything is bolt in and then just tune it when you get it all sorted at the end, I guess.
And
then suspension and wheel alignment.
It just really needs a diff built, tail shaft, the rest of the exhaust system built on it, some water cooling for the supercharger for the intercooler.
Right.
And we've got a loom and a harness and a ECU for it, so a lot of it's just plugged
in. So what ECU is going to be? It's a factory ECU. Interesting.
They do a standalone kit for it.
Oh, okay. I thought you were going to run a Hellcat or something like that.
Hellcat.
I thought you were going to run.
Look, if it all turns sideways they run it. They sort of run it, a standalone kit which comes with the engine from America with the pedal, the accelerator pedal, and everything to it.
To make it standalone.
And we use HP tuners, which I'm very familiar with. To tune it.
So there's enough parameters in the factory ECU to adjust for bigger camshaft and stuff like that, different pulleys. Okay, that's good to know.
It's all, and they sort of give you a calibration of sort to start it. So I'll see what it's like.
Start-up calibration.
And we should be able to just trim it up and for the camshaft.
Away you go and blow some tyres.
It's always a plan.
Anyway, we'll have a walk around in a minute, but that's the engine looks pretty big sitting in the mirror, actually. But the motor's sitting in there in its right place. Clears the hood, which we're a little bit worried about. I've heard others say there's no issues, but until you've done it, you don't know. But we left the grill out on purpose because it's easier for Mark to lean over and work over it over having a shiny grill. So as much as it is now, that's as much assembly as I'm doing. And then I'm handballing it to Mark, and he's doing the rest of it.
Well, in saying that, I just want to thank Brian, because this car was a bit of a mess. Body-wise, we sort of... obviously you've done some videos on it, but having it here before we painted it was, the car is good, the body's good, but it took a lot of work from Brian, and then he turned it over very, very quickly. But we're just over the moon with the quality of work and the time frame and the help, just, sourcing parts that we weren't familiar with.
Yeah.
And just getting everything out for the reversing frame.
No, that's good. No, appreciate that, Mark. Thanks for all your lies. I like it.
No, we really do, and we work well together.
We do, we do. Yeah. Mark and I do quite a bit together for our customers as well, so that works out really well. It's handy to have people on two sides of the fence what they do.
Look, if we're going to do stuff like this, if we've got the help of the paint and the panel, and we've both got some mechanical knowledge, But without you, we couldn't do, you know.
Well, you know, you would have got it done, but it would have been maybe a bit harder, perhaps, but or a few different places. But anyway, the main thing is we're there now, so I'll do a walk around and you can see what the end result is. So we'll just have a quick walk around. Don't worry, the wheels on the front are temporary. Just getting it rolling so we can get out of the shop. I've just put door handles, mirrors, some of the stainless on, wheel lip mouldings, bonnet mouldings, just so that it's easy for them later. And then they've got to do the interior dash and they've got to completely rewire the car. So there's quite a lot to do. We've got lots of things in the way here. Looks quite pretty at the back. Yeah, very attractive car, the Challenger. Beautiful curvy lines. Very sexy looking car. Hopefully a happy customer. No fuel tank in yet. It's looking good.
The Grand Fury's finally arrived. Very slow process. All the cars being shipped got held up because of the Daytona parts, which was nearly a year from when I ordered it to when I actually got them, but at least I got them. So the Fury, along with the three other cars, had to sit and wait. They finally arrived. So this is a really sharp Grand Fury 86. I said before, not everybody's collect them, but I reckon they're really cool, just something a bit different. This was if you haven't looked back at my previous videos, this was a 75,000 mile original paint. Just a lovely original example that I found on my travels. And, you know, especially in Australia, you don't see them. In America, you know, not so collectible, they are around. But it always makes a big difference when you get one that's really clean. Now look at the interior on this one. Look at that. You wouldn't think it had done 75,000 miles even. The condition of the door trims. Nicely appointed, the dash is lovely. Dash pad. Just a beautiful example. And this is going to a new owner. One of my friends is going to take it. I haven't got any more space. So we might see it out on the road there one day.